We are live. This is the Total OS Today Show podcast right here on the terrific LinuxDistroCommunity.com. Now, this is currently a weekly podcast, 9 p.m. New York time, Eastern time here in the States, discussing basically technology for the common man. But every once in a while, we will go a bit off topic. Well, for tonight's show, way off topic. Now, this is a Fishing with Dynamite show. It's a figure of speech. This is a this is a this hang on. This is a term I coined many, many years ago when I would go fishing with my friends. And of course, for those of you who fish, it's possible to fish all day and catch zero. Well, as a former New Yorker with little patience, I would say, guys, you guys really do not know how to fish. Put away your fishing poles, grab a couple sticks of dynamite, throw it in the water, you can catch all the fish you want. Now, it was nonsense. It was meant to be a joke. It was meant to be silly. It was meant to be off topic, hence fishing with dynamite, which is tonight's show. And you already heard some nonsense laughing from my co-host Spatry, who will fill us in on who will be talking nonsense for this evening.
Well, we have everybody in here, and I don't know who will be talking and who won't, but let me read off the list of everybody that's here. We've got Armageddon, we've got Coldy, we got LT Dano, Preacher, Raven from Australia, having Vegemite toast myself, and Total OS today.
Now, before we get on the topic of Vegemite, which is very appetizing, Spatry,
That looks like axle grease on bread.
Raven, you'll get your chance. But hey, Spatry, speaking of fishing, you know, last week I went fishing with Chuck Norris. But Chuck Norris does not go fishing. Out of fear, the fish go to Chuck Norris.
Oh, okay.
And do you know how he goes lobster fishing? He puts a little note inside the cage saying, "Jump in or else."
I thought that would happen if you were going fishing with Charles Bronson.
Well, I don't know Charles Bronson personally, but that may work out that way, sure.
Yeah, he goes fishing with a 44 Magnum.
Boy, we're talking tough. Let me try one more. And this is how tough Chuck Norris is. Chuck Norris once got hit by a train. Nobody on the train survived. Okay, so enough of the tough guy jokes. Raven, the Vegemite sandwich, could you explain to us what that is?
The Vegemite sandwich, or Vegemite in general, is basically manufactured and made in Australia, where I'm from, hence the accent. It's actually, well, outsiders' interpretation of Vegemite basically to them is, motor oil or axle grease on toast, as Spatry would say. But yeah, it's very appetizing, to be honest with you. And speaking about that, my 2-year-old son's just got a piece of toast with Vegemite on it here, so he's riding to it. He's 2 years old. He loves it. Very high in vitamin B, very rich in iron. Taste-wise, it basically tastes like I'd say very salty, like vinegar, and yeah, all that sort of stuff. But yeah, very, very nice. It is healthy, but originally Vegemite was the way it was manufactured was basically was the leftovers of yeast that were taken from beer kegs after when the pubs had finished with the kegs. They extract the rest of the yeast out of the base of the kegs, and then basically thinged it off to the Vegemite factory, and then we'll go through a process, and then voila, out comes the black eagle, black axle grease.
Now, battery, heck off. All right, so it now is this a product, something that can be eaten for breakfast, lunch, and dinner?
It can be eaten 24 hours a day, even when you're asleep, mate.
Some prefer to take it intravenously.
Yes, indeed, yes.
A food for all seasons.
Yes, indeed, and it's also very, 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 very delicious with you know, eggs, even with cheese, as Preach has told me himself. But yeah, very, very nice with, you know, melted cheese on toast. Oh, yes.
Is this product even available here in the States?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
You know what? I will have to check it out just out of curiosity, and I will let you guys know.
Yeah, I think it should be on the same shelf as the peanut butters, the Nutellas, and all those other things, you know, like where they have all the jams and jellies and peanut butters and all that stuff.
And this is strictly an Australian invention, Raven?
Yes, that's exactly correct, mate. Yes, Australian made, invented, and Australian manufactured, so yes.
Okay, well, since we're on the topic of food, we have other guests on the show. Armageddon, do you have a favorite unusual food?
Not really, no. I usually eat everything.
Coldy?
Not literally, but yeah, everything.
I couldn't really think of anything. I mean, I don't really like to eat things that look kind of odd. Especially something that looks like axle grease. I'm not so sure I want to try that. I'll let you do that one, Turtle OS, today.
Okay, well, I just had a thought. If you want to eat something that looks odd, just come fishing with me and Spatch, you know, when we go fishing with depth charges, and you'll find all the odd stuff. All right. Dano, what do you eat?
Pretty much anything. You know, I'll try it once just to, just to see what it's like, but I haven't tried veggie at all.
Preacher.
I don't think anything odd, which might not be particularly what someone else would eat. Just regional things. I'm from the South in the States, so we definitely have our own little flavors here and there.
Oh, well, if you're in the South, would grits be a popular food?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Plain with breakfast and then cheese grits with fried catfish. Very tasty.
Yes. I love grits myself. I love cheese grits. And I remember the first time I had it when I was a kid. I thought it was cream of wheat. But actually, no, it's completely different. All the kids were putting salt and pepper on it, and I tried it. I love it.
Now, the foods that we have talked about, can we use technology to eat it? Now, when I say technology, could I use my microwave?
Microwave Vegemite on toast. If you want it hot, you can have it hot. Modern technology means of actually, warming Vegemite up. Yes, you can. Wouldn't be advisable to stick it in a frying pan or something like that and fry it. But yeah, if you want it hot, as in terms of the microwave, shouldn't be a problem.
Does it taste better hot or cold?
Tastes better stone cold, mate.
Okay, I will keep that in mind. Spatchery, don't you have an unusual food intake in that can with the skull and bones on it?
Just a dash of arsenic with my liver and onions.
That caffeine drink, what's it called again?
Oh, the Arizona Energy Drinks. Yeah, they're only 99 cents a can. Yeah. Just Arizona. You know what? I can't even remember the name of it. Hold on.
I wonder if it performs, if it has the same effect like caffeine, like coffee.
Yeah, the can just says... Arizona Energy Drink Extreme Performance with caution on the label.
Should we comment on that, gentlemen, or move on?
Sounds good.
Say, Total OS today, I gotta ask you a question.
Yes.
Okay, now, I don't know if you or any of you guys are aware of this, but back when Windows 7 came out, Microsoft had some training slides that they had that were going out to Best Buy employees that was spreading a lot of fear, uncertainty, and doubt about the Linux operating system. And most of the information on these slides was clearly untrue, basically saying that Windows is safer and more secure than Linux. Saying that their updates were better than Ubuntu, with Ubuntu getting updates every day, and they were saying that's kind of dodgy, you know, that Linux gets all these updates all the time, whereas our updates are a lot better for your system. But at any rate, they had all this fear, uncertainty, and doubt and everything to educate or misinform Best Buy employees. I guess this was at the time. You'll remember when we had the netbook craze, okay? And a lot of netbooks were hitting the store shelves, and they were getting different variants of Linux installed on them. Mostly, I think it was MeeGo. And so immediately, Microsoft, released a service pack 3 of XP, because at the time, Vista wouldn't run on netbooks. And then, of course, now Windows 7 will. They, you know, lightened up the system requirements and that sort of thing. And I'm just wondering if they're going to do something like this again when Windows 8 is ready to hit the store shelves. Because now we have Chromebooks on the shelves. And everybody knows Chromebooks is running a form of Linux.
Well, this is my take. Okay, just briefly. Do you want to know what really helped promote Linux or more widely spread Linux as an alternative? Microsoft Vista did. And probably, if Windows 8 turns out to be a bomb, I don't think it'll bomb on the tablet, but if it bombs on the test desktop, this may prove to be an open door for Ubuntu or Zorin. Armageddon, what do you got?
My question to Spatry is, when did they stop? I mean, they're claiming that Internet Explorer 8 is the most secure and fastest browser out there. I mean, it's faster than IE7, and IE7 is faster than IE6, but if you look at the benchmarking, all of them are, you know, at the bottom benchmarking, and there's a difference of like 1500 points with against the slowest of the browsers out there. They will never stop doing that misinforming thing. I mean, it's their job to do that.
Yeah, now the thing is, here's the point I'm trying to illustrate. Let's say you're in Best Buy, Circuit City, or a major technology retailer, okay? You have two identical computers. Let's say both of them are made by HP. They're both laptop computers. They both have a quad core. They both have 6 gigs of RAM. They both have the same video interface. Now, would you choose Windows 8 that has a 30-day trial on its Office software, a 30-day trial on its antivirus, and pretty much all the other bundleware that comes loaded with this, and not necessarily really good bundleware, but a lot of this bundleware obviously is going to have a time-limited trial, obviously because they want more coin out of your pocket, versus another computer that's sitting next to it, identical machines, but the other computer is running Ubuntu. It has all the drivers, all the software you need installed on it, and it has a price tag of about maybe $150, $200 cheaper. Which computer do you think the end consumer is going to pick?
In my opinion, well, I would pick the cheaper one. But in my opinion, the problem is not the system itself. It's not the laptop and it's not the software on it. It's the people that are selling it. Those are the people that are not educated enough to sell the Linux computer. For example, they claim that, hey, you're not going to get support. Well, which is wrong, because if you want support, you're going to have to pay for it, but you will have support. They will claim that Windows application will not work, but they don't tell the users that why they don't work and that there are alternatives that are cheaper, most of the time are free. They're not informed enough to educate the buyer on what's the differences between both operating systems and which one will give them more performance. I know from the people I talk to that a lot of people that buy the netbook that already has Windows 7 on it, they usually format that and install Linux on it because it will run better on the specs of the same netbook. And I know a lot of people that have no idea about Linux that just install it because it runs much, much better on the same exact computers that they bought that they had Windows 7 on.
I'd like to mention, too, Armageddon said something about it's not so much the hardware, software, it's the people, the stores or the retail outlets. One thing interesting I heard today, earlier, I think, I'm sure, yeah, Cold was there, and I don't know who else. Popey was in. I was unaware of the Ubuntu stores. 850 opened, or are in operation, what, in India? And I could see that really taking off if they would, you know, try to pull that off, say, here in the States or other countries. Kind of like, you know, the Apple stores, especially after listening to their work on the tablets, their phones, TVs, and, you know, computers. I think that would be a good boost or an alternative, certainly, to people looking for computers and whatnot.
What do you say about that, Total SJ? Yeah.
I think, and yeah, I mean, as far as the Ubuntu stores in India, didn't you and I do a Center report? We cracked a little joke about the Indian stores and the llamas and stuff, what they use. Yeah.
Well, the numbers that Popey
I do remember
about.
That, yes.
Well, Popey was talking some impressive numbers today as far as how well they have been received. And I could see that, or I would hope to see as good of a reception here to give people an alternative.
Okay, here's my thought on this. As a Windows dual booter, I would love to see Ubuntu stores at the very least. Why? Well, at the very least as a choice. But here's the thing. If I'm in Ubuntu store and I'm shopping, and I need to make sure. Now, let's try this. Mom and pop go into the Ubuntu store. There is a salesperson, a nice, knowledgeable salesperson. That salesperson needs to be completely upfront and honest with these, I would imagine, who are prospective Linux, desktop Linux buyers coming from, say, Windows 7. Ubuntu Linux should have a guarantee. Everything that is pre-installed will work out of the box, just like Windows 7. The problem is, and continues to be, the quality control with the pre-installed software will be great, but once they browse into the Ubuntu Software Center, the Synaptic Package Manager, and all the other thousands, tens of thousands pieces of software that are out there, those, unfortunately, do not have quality control. So let's say they take their new Ubuntu desktop home. And it's great because you don't necessarily have to have any antivirus or anti-spyware. It seems to run a little bit faster. They love the Unity environment. It looks terrific. Perhaps they like it better than what they've seen with Windows 8. And all of the software works. But you know what? They would like to try some multimedia, you know, editing, so they download Kden Live and it crashes 10% of the time. Now, that is not Ubuntu's fault. That is not the hardware fault. That comes to a non-standardized quality control environment that is unfortunately still inherent to the desktop Linux. Mom and pop is probably going to bring that back, unless the salesman or sales lady told the person ahead of time, this is better than Windows because of runs faster, it's cheaper, no antivirus, boots a little faster. This is worse than Windows because of the quality control issue and the lack of a standardized piece of desktop environment. As long as the mom and pop consumer know that, I would have no issue with that. As long as they know what they're buying and what the Linux desktop can do and what it cannot do.
If I would have an intake on this, well, I don't see buying an application out there being any better. For example, let's say you buy any piece of software on the internet and then you download it and install it on your system, or even if you don't buy it, just download it for free, which is free, then you're not going to help for that. If it's free, you're not going to get help for that. And if it's not free, you're going to call customer support, and then they're going to try as much as possible to fix it for you, which the community does usually. And if it doesn't work, then it doesn't work. On the other hand, when what you have is a piece of software, whatever the software is, it's usually free, and even if it's not, you're going to have community support on the one hand, which people should be educated on that, and on the other hand, you have the bug report, the Bugzilla, where you can go in and then post your problems, and in the next release, you're going to have those problems fixed, and if the problem is major, it's going to get fixed faster than, you know, a normal problem if it's not your fault. I mean, you don't usually have those in applications that you buy. For example, when I used to work at school and we bought a piece of software that didn't work on the hardware, they tried as much as possible to make it work better, but it didn't, and it was their fault. All they could say is, that's how it works, and that's it. There's nothing they can do about it.
I have to agree, though, that an educated salesman who gives detailed information to the consumer is going to be a really valuable thing. So, for instance, let's say, yes, I'm the salesman, total loss today, you're the consumer, you're coming in buying the Ubuntu computer, you like it because the price is $200 cheaper, okay, and you want to do some video editing and that sort of thing. As the educated salesman, I would tell you, okay, yes, KDN Live is a wonderful solution for doing those video editing, and if you ever run into any problems on it, KDN Live has a wonderful website where you can find a bunch of answers for, you know, so if you ever run into issues with KDN Live, they can actually help you through their forums find answers that you're looking for so that, you know, you can avoid those crashes and that sort of thing. I mean, that's the same thing I went through myself, and that's one reason why I'm running KDN Live SVN and not the KDN Live from the Ubuntu software repositories, because the Ubuntu software repository, the version they have there always crashes on me. But the SVN version, on the other hand, has its own version of Melt, the freer plugins and everything, and that works fine for me, and it never crashes, never gives me any trouble, any issues and that sort of thing. But yes, educating the customer, but also letting them know, hey, KDN Live does require a little bit of a learning curve. If you want something that's a little bit easier to do your video editing, you know, there are some other choices as well. You've got OpenShot, you've got PTV, you got Lives, you got a bunch of other little programs that you can use. All of them are free to download and try out and use. It's not going to cost you anything to download most of the software from the Software Center. So, you know, if one item doesn't work well for you, there are plenty of other choices.
I can't help but still state that the lack of a desktop Linux environment, you know, on the store shelves, at least here in the United States, and I don't know what it is in other countries such as Australia, but the lack of that has to come down to a lack of a standardized quality control desktop, a single desktop environment, and the accompanying software that the community can rally upon that one single desktop environment. But here's the conundrum. Linux's strength, which is multiple choices, is also its weakness. So, you know, I would love to see Ubuntu stores here in the States, Zorin stores, Linux Mint stores, but getting back to the question of, or the statement of community, totally agree. The community, at least for me, if I have a question or want to find an answer, it is terrific. Now, to be fair to the Windows community, I really haven't been in there that much because since I know what I'm doing, I don't have as many issues. Now, maybe the Windows community is not as friendly, less friendly, or just as good. I will be fair about this and say they are probably just as friendly if you have the patience. Now, that's the key word, patience. With Linux, you do need a little bit more patience. But the bottom line is, any desktop you buy off the shelves for the non-geek household, you know, they want it to work out of the box. They don't have the patience because they don't have time with their busy lives, and that's completely understandable. You know, they're buying a desktop Linux or a desktop Windows to work. They don't want nonsense. They don't want to go fishing with dynamite. You know, yeah, we joke here, make fun of technology because we know what we're doing, or at least we think we know what we're doing, and that's fine. But the customer wants a desktop environment to not go fishing with dynamite or fishing with the community or fishing for answers. They want it to work out of the box, at least with the pre-installed software that comes with it. Now, I can't think of any problems I've had in Windows with either free software, free trial, or free, and then I bought it. I don't recall having any issues whatsoever, because I still believe today that the quality control is a little bit better. Now, this can change if the Linux community, if the powers that be can rally around one universal standard quality piece of Linux-based desktop, it will sell, because number one, it is going to be cheaper and people today are on a budget. But it has to work out of the box without any fear of, gee, I downloaded something new, now how does this work? Raven, what is the state of desktop Linux in Australia?
The state of desktop Linux in Australia, as far as I know, I'm not sure or too aware of the statistics at this moment in time, but from what I know, in the town where I live, in a population of 25,000, I live in Kempsey, New South Wales, here in Australia, which is about 5 hours north of Sydney, 6 hours north of Sydney, and out in the middle of nowhere. There are a few Linux users around here, a few of them that I have converted over myself, but yeah, you don't sort of hear too much about Linux here in this town. The two or three computer shops here in the town, here in this town, basically, you know, you're just your normal computer shops that commercially deal with, you know, Microsoft products and stuff like that, and computers and whatever else. But yeah, I'm not sort of too sure about the statistics, but yeah, I'll have to look that one up.
Spatry, you might like this. I came across, I was watching TV last week, a football game. I think it was the football game with my beloved Dallas Cowboys, and they won.
Boo!
But you might like this. I saw a commercial, a Microsoft commercial, which was a pretty slick 30-second commercial. They were promoting IE9, and I'm looking at this commercial, and I saw a blurb, you know, a statement from a reviewer saying, IE9 smoked the competition. Spatry, this is when you say, really? Well, what were they smoking?
Yeah, they were smoking something.
Who was the competition?
Their competition would be IE8.
Yeah, really.
Ba-da-boom, ba-da-beep. Yeah.
Yeah, really. Yeah, it's funny. You know, when I go out to these computer stores, because I've been out shopping around for a computer, and I like to bring my little flash drive. I've got Linux Mint 13 XFCE on it. And it's really funny because I let the salesman know, look, I need to boot this computer using the flash drive, because if I buy this machine today, I need to make sure that everything, you know, that the Linux is going to be able to power all the peripherals on this machine. Otherwise, I can't buy it because I don't agree with the Microsoft end user license agreement, blah, blah, blah. And of course, all the time, Best Buy employees are telling me, oh, well, you're going to void the warranty, you know, if you remove Windows and install Linux on it. I says, that's a bunch of nonsense, I says, because, you know, HP, for instance, they sell computers with Linux on it. So, no, that's not going to void the warranty, you know. Because I mean, if that were true, then, you know, if you install any piece of software on that computer, then you're changing its functionality, in essence. So if you install Adobe Photoshop on that computer, you have changed what the computer can do. Hence, you're voiding the warranty?
Right,
I don't think so. And pretty much, I tell these salespeople, if you're not going to let me boot this machine off a flash drive or off a live DVD, you don't get the sale today, you know? And I actually find myself educating the salespeople, because I already know what I'm looking for. And I basically explain to them why I think Linux is better. It's really funny to see, you know, to have that kind of interaction with the salespeople to educate them, because it's like I've had a few salespeople. I basically tell them about my show. I says, you want to know more about this OS, just check out my show on YouTube. And I tell them how to get to it and that sort of thing. I even had one salesman pull it up on the computer And he subscribed to my show right there. And because they were fascinated by that, you know, that you can, you know, that you can run a operating system off of a flash drive and that sort of thing, just to test it out before you even take the hardware home. So I think it's good that we as consumers who know about Linux and use it on a day-to-day basis, we can actually educate these salespeople, you know?
One of my favorite fishing with dynamite moments, or I don't know, maybe like an embarrassing moment for Microsoft, not to bash Microsoft, I thoroughly enjoy Windows 7, but I was watching a video from Locker Gnome, and I believe it was Chris Perillo's father. Now, you talk about an honest...
Yes, I remember that one.
Okay, well, let me fill this into the rest of the crew. You talk about an honest and open, out-of-the-box experience. So Chris basically tells his dad, I think his name is Joe, and if it is, hi, Joe, and if I got it wrong, sorry. But anyway, he tells his dad, and the camera's running, he says, hey, Dad, just check out the Windows 8 beta and just get him play around and tell me what you think. Well, he's doing this, talking, doing this, doing that, up and down, left and right. And after about, I don't know, 5 minutes, maybe 10 minutes, he says, what's this called? And who makes this? And Chris replies, Microsoft. And his dad replies, are they trying to drive me to Mac?
Yeah, I remember that.
He was honest because it was totally, you know, he was looking for the start button for the menu. And it's, you know, he didn't know. Well, I guess he didn't know where to start. As far as, you know, embarrassing moments for a company, I guess that would be one of them. Well, speaking of embarrassing moment, let's go down the list here. Tell us one of your most embarrassing moments using a computer. Now, for an example, there have been times more than once where I'll start to do a video, I'll start talking, play it back, and there's no sound. And basically, I made it a fool out of myself because I forgot to uncheck the mute button. So that's been multiple embarrassing moments for myself. But Armageddon, what is one of your most embarrassing moments using a computer?
Well, by the way, that happened to me as well. I was trying to find help, and it turns out that I had it muted. It was on the new laptop because I already had problems with the old kernels not supporting my hardware. With the new ones, it works fine. But I remember last year I had a presentation to do in class, and I took out my laptop, you know, to plug it in and everything. And there's a problem with the cables in there, and sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. So you're not really sure if it's your laptop or the actual screen or the actual the machine that you plug in yourself to. And everyone was like, "Hey, FN and F5, whatever." I'm like, guys, I know, but I'm running Linux. That doesn't work in here. It works on Windows. And I kept trying to fix it, and it wouldn't work. So I had to stop everything, and then I was like, you know what? I'll do the presentation after everyone finishes, so I'll try to fix it while I'm seating. So I took my laptop back, and I sat down, and I left everyone to do their presentations ahead of me.
Coldy, what you got?
Before I talk about that, I want to add on to the Chris Perillo thing.
Yes.
As far as Windows 8, he did a live demonstration of Windows 8, and during the installation, he had the new blue screen of death. All live.
I remember that.
Yeah, that's all I'm going to add to that. So as far as embarrassing moments for a company, that would be one of them. As far as one of my embarrassing moments, I was in Mumble and in the LDC, and my headset has a mute button, and it flashes red. However, it's not very noticeable, and I had a friend over, and I'm sitting here talking and talking and talking and lighting up, and I was practically talking to myself. No one heard me, and I just assumed they were just being quiet, and he looks over and he says, "You realize you're talking to yourself," and I just felt really bad at that point, and I was glad no one else could hear that.
Coldy, I hate to break to you, but the problem was Spatry was trying out his new speech jamming device.
Well, it works.
Dano, what you got?
Well, most embarrassing moments. I tried to wipe my hard drive, and I had a program installed on the Windows side, Dual Boot. I had a bootable CD of the same program. And for some reason or another, I thought I was running off of the CD. It was in the drive. It was running. Everything was good. I went to wipe the hard drives. It had got about halfway through and just completely crashed. And I couldn't figure out why. Well, it turns out I was using the program that was installed on the Windows side. Windows was up and running, and I just clicked wipe, and it completely wiped it all out. While it was just operator error. I just completely, just messed up.
We are all human. Preacher, how about some Southern embarrassment?
Well, it's definitely embarrassment, but I don't know so much as, it was produced from the computer, but make a long story short, an Ubuntu Loco team I was in a few years ago, I'm always keeping or taking, 30 or 40 Ubuntu CDs to the shows when I go to hand out. And when I had burned, it's CDs I burned myself, and probably 2 weeks before this show, a co-worker, I'm a retired state trooper, so this was a film we had filmed. We had a party for another trooper that was getting married, and we had a couple of, I'm going to keep it clean, but we had a couple of females at the party, and of course there was alcoholic beverages being served, and we filmed some of the stuff, and I handed out about 25, I don't know how I made them, it was by mistake, but instead of 25 people getting a copy of the latest Ubuntu, they got a preview of our shenanigans.
Can you send me one of those?
And, to make it worse, I was still employed at the time, and my superiors, or all of our superiors, weren't very receptive of it, and we caught hell.
I can just imagine, out of respect to you guys who protect and serve, I will disregard all the jokes in my head. But I'm sure Spatchery won't.
That's a good one, though. The one thing that drives me nuts, because I fix a lot of computers for people, and mostly notebooks. I have people that, bring their notebooks over to me. They really like what I've been doing with Linux and that sort of thing. And they are complaining they can't get their Wi-Fi working and that sort of thing. And, it's maniacal the way some of these manufacturers, they put a little button for the Wi-Fi in a place that you can easily hit it by accident and shut it off.
Same thing here on my Toshiba.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. And so, for instance, one of my roommates, I put Linux on his, I put a copy of PinGuy, this was a few months ago, for PinGuy OS on it. And one day he said the Wi-Fi stopped working. And so I'm sitting there fighting with this thing without even realizing there was a Wi-Fi button on the damn thing. So all I had to do was just push the Wi-Fi button and it would start working again.
But, I just realized something. The original, some of the earlier podcasts I done, the Toscasts podcasts I did with IG, I don't recall shutting off my cell phone, my house phone. I don't recall getting interrupted once. Talk about a broad stroke of luck. Of course, now I shut off my cell phone or just put it on vibrate, or, if my son's with me, I turn down the TV or shut down the house phone. But in the beginning, it never really occurred to me till later on. But I guess that would have been embarrassing too. Of course, those much earlier shows were not being recorded live. But listen, we are human. We all have our moments, but that that story by Preacher, that's number one story of the month.
I just remembered the story I had. I used to work as an IT in a company, and we usually back up, if the user wants to back up his stuff before we reinstall Windows for him, we usually do that. And actually, I took the... No, what happened was someone else backed up everything. I was like, okay, I backed up everything. And I'm like, okay, so I can format now? So he's like, okay, fine, format that computer. And I just hit the format. We were three people working. So I hit the format and started installing Windows. And as it started installing Windows, the third guy was searching the other computer for the backup. And then he called the second guy that told me that he backed up everything. He's like, where's the backup? He's like, it's right there. And they searched for the backup, and there's no backup. So basically, I formatted a computer with all the information for the user on it. He lost every single piece of information out there. So we had to stop the installation and do a full recovery from his hard drive. The good thing is I did a fast format, not a sector by sector format, so we could we did get most of his information.
Spatry, that story goes into the Fishing with Dynamite Hall of Shame.
Oh, yeah, you know what? It's funny you mentioned that because I had a problem where I accidentally cleared out some data from a backup flash drive. But fortunately, there is a neat little tool that you run from the command line called Foremost. And in this case, it was a bunch of JPEG images that were backed up images. And so I was actually able to recover all those images quite easily. Yeah.
Well, gentlemen, I think we have come to the conclusion of this entertaining, fun Fishing with Dynamite show. And once again, before I do end the show, I want to say to all the listeners, we do not actually advocate fishing with dynamite. Once again,
yes, you do. Yes, you do.
You may send all of your lawsuits down to Florida in care of Spatchery's
yeah, send that in care of Spatchery's cup of shiznits.
Thank you very much. So I do not advocate now fishing with depth charges, not a problem. No, I'm just kidding. But thank you for listening. Thanks to all the guests here. Spatchery, thank you as always for
being thank you.
Terrific co-host. Preacher, if you have any spare discs of your party, please send it to me. But well, maybe not. I don't want to get you in trouble, but cool story. But yeah, thank you to all of the guests for this evening. Next Sunday night show, Spatchery, I don't know. Do you have something in mind?
Not really.
Okay, we'll have to get together during the week and see what's up. But thanks to all of you here on the Linux Distro community listening in, and those of you who will be listening in soon once I upload this in the next couple days. Once again, this is the Live Total OS Today Show podcast. You are welcome to join either as a speaking guest or as a listener. You need to download Mumble. And I believe Mumble is available for both Windows and Linux. Check out the Total OS Today website. Also, check out Spatchery's Cup of Linux. He has a terrific series of videos for newbies for the Linux Mint XFCE. And Spatchery, have you finished that series?
Yeah, it's been finished for some time now. But, you know, I might do some other... I might do another bootcamp series. Who knows? As Windows 8 approaches, I'm sure we're going to need a tutorial series on Ubuntu, so I might actually do that.
Sounds good. Once again, thank you, Armageddon, Coldy, IT Dano, Preacher, of course, Spatchery, Raven, and from myself, Total OS Today, we will catch all of you sometime in your dual booting future. Ciao. And by the way, Spatchery, you know, we tried to end the show with Ciao, the Toscast podcast with me, you, and, you know, an IG and or somebody else. Now, when I say Ciao, okay, which is Italian, I say it with class, with eloquence, with patience. When you say Ciao, you say Ciao. You sound like a character in one of the Halo games. You know what I mean? Like, ciao, like, ciao, pass the grids, pass the chow. Instead of saying ciao or adios, you say ciao.
Hold on, let me practice here.
Ciao. Oh, yeah, much better. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We will leave that outtake in. Goodbye.
Get up!